And now, your go-to source for year-round fantasy hockey advice, DFS and betting coverage. This is NHL Fantasy on Ice, presented by Skip, the official food delivery app of the NHL.
It is early, but a lot of fantasy owners already have questions. Luckily, my friends, we have answers. Brought to you by our good friends over at Skip. Welcome to another edition of NHL Fantasy on Ice, Week 2 Mailbag Edition. Nick Alberga and Jake Hahn with you. What's going on, Jake?
I certainly have questions. I hope I have some answers, Nick. I have some fantasy problems to go through on this episode. Obviously, this episode brought to you by Skip, the official food delivery app of the NHL.
As per usual, Jake, lots coming up on today's podcast. Speak of questions, there's a lot of answers with our man Pete Jensen. He's coming up. I'm going to hold him accountable for the Buffalo Sabres. We'll talk about that also. We'll answer some of your questions via Instagram. Thank you so much for those. And we'll also be joined by Tyler Mataraz of SiriusXM NHL Network Radio for his first ever appearance on the pod, Jake.
Love it. You know, me and Ty go way back. We're great friends, co-workers as well. So looking forward to having Mataraz a part of the program. Hopefully something we can get involved with throughout the course of the year. Someone has to answer for the Sabres, Nick. Someone does. Like, what are we doing here at this point?
That was the first thing I wanted to bring up on today's podcast. We're now banned. Everybody on this podcast banned from saying the two words Buffalo Sabres. I'm so finished with that team, Jake. I think they're done already. I think they're finished, man.
Well, they're the type of team, and you see this with a few other teams, that if you ever needed a good start and some confidence at the beginning of a season, it's a team like the Buffalo Sabres. And once again, it's a bad start. You're digging yourself a hole in a difficult division. So maybe I'm not calling them done like you are, but I'm my faith is just completely gone. I told you guys off air, the only thing I'm willing to back in Buffalo right now is the J.J. Paterka goal prop, the J.J. Paterka shot prop. That's where it ends, right there. Maybe an Alex Tuck assist prop or something like that. But outside of that, no more Buffalo for me.
I texted my buddy Quinner, who is the biggest Buffalo Sabres fan you can find, and unsurprisingly, he is in one right now. We pull for our friends down in Buffalo, maybe get things together, but that's just another prototypical Buffalo Sabres loss where you're up in that game, you're looking good against the Pittsburgh Penguins, and you blow it. But Jake, I got to give you some props here. Filip Gustavsson, Minnesota, you've been all over this file for the last couple months, 2-0-1. Five goals against, 1.66, 948, and he's got a power play goal.
Well, I appreciate you giving me props on my good goalie call. There's a couple other goalie calls that, you know, maybe have gone the other way for me the first week, but I'll take the credit when it's given on Filip Gustavsson. And I was not expecting a goalie goal, obviously, but I do think this could become a bit of a trend in the NHL. We've seen goalie goals go up the last couple of years, and Gustavsson gets one early, and, you know, teams pulling goaltenders. We saw Vegas-Colorado game the first week of the season, Nick. Three-goal lead, goalie pull with like 5 or 6 minutes left. If you're goaltender isn't like hanging near the blue line, what are we even doing here, right? You got to get him those touches. So I think we're going to see a few more goalie goals, and on Filip Gustavsson, I mean the crease is his. If he wants it, if he wants to run out and take it and tell Jesper Wallstedt wait another year, I think the crease is there for him all season.
It's funny, I was watching the Wild broadcast the other night, and they had mentioned that the Wild apparently told Wallstedt to get an apartment in Minnesota, in St. Paul. Like, knowing they had three goalies, that makes no sense to me.
Well, and that was one of my other goalie calls, if you remember, in the offseason, was that I thought Wallstedt would be sneaky in a deep league. Like, your third or fourth goaltender, you know, get him in there. Maybe he gets a couple starts in the first 2 weeks of the season, and he can kind of run with it. And we haven't seen him. He's up and he's down, and he hasn't even gotten a start yet. So I don't know what they're doing in Minnesota. The fact that they told him to get an apartment, though, tells me that at some point he's going to get a game. So if you stashed him like I did, just hang on for that first start. But I understand, you know, you get frustrated, you see someone on the wire, and you've got a guy sitting there that isn't even playing a game, collecting dust on your roster.
Jake, here's where we earn the big bucks, delivered by our good friends over at Skip. A lot of people asking about Tristan Jarry. 12 goals on 72 shots to start his campaign. What would you do if you owned Tristan Jarry right now?
I would throw up in a bag. That's what I would do if I owned Tristan Jarry right now. It's rough, man. It's rough out there for a lot of goaltenders. Luckily, I don't have Jarry in any of my leagues, but I have some other brutal goaltenders that are putting up similar numbers. I mean, at this point, if you're in an 8, 10, 12 team league, I think maybe you could look elsewhere. But if you're in a deep league, there's just not too many other options. I think you got to stick with Jarry and hope he plays himself out of it. But I wouldn't be shocked if he loses that net at some point, Nick. I don't know if you feel differently about this, but with the performance he's been given the Penguins to start the year, is he a trade candidate? Is he a candidate to lose his job? He's not a guy I'd be excited to start in fantasy hockey.
He just can't make a save right now. I think, obviously, I'm benching him for the foreseeable future. And, Jake, I won't lie. A couple more starts like this, I'm just cutting bait with Tristan Jarry. I wasn't a believer in Pittsburgh to begin with. There's nothing that leads me to believe that things are suddenly going to change overnight for this team. I think it would be an easy cut over the next week or so.
Well, and I think that's a good topic in general. Like, how loyal do we stay to these guys that we drafted, whether it's a goaltender that's getting crushed like a Jarry, or you look around the rest of the league, there's a lot of other frustrating goaltending situations, or even a player that you were maybe high on that just isn't performing. Like, do you wait a week? Do you wait 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month? Are you impatient, Nick? Like, when's your benchmark for, okay, I got to make a decision on some of these players?
Depends on the team, depends on the goalie. As I mentioned, for Pittsburgh specifically, I don't believe in the team. I don't think they're going to make the playoffs. I don't like them defensively. So there's like a checklist for me. And unfortunately, every box is checked in favor of dumping Tristan Jarry, Jake.
At least Sid's getting going, which is nice. He gets the overtime winner. Even Gino, you know, he gets the big goal, and he's been okay the last couple of games as well. Brian Rust is back from that short-term injury that he had, so I think he's a little bit of a spark in that top six. Offensively, maybe there's something in Pittsburgh, because I remember when we spoke last week, Nick, it was doom and gloom after that first game, right? We thought, are they going to be a lottery team this year? They at least look like they're going to be able to provide some offense in that top six. Maybe we look to Tony Beauvillier, who's getting a good look on that top line as well. So some value in Pittsburgh. It's just not between the pipes.
I was looking ahead to the schedule as well. They had a game in Winnipeg, I think, this weekend. It could have been a classic Rutger McGroarty revenge game, but now he finds himself in the American Hockey League. And by the way, with Anaheim's game the other night, Cutter Gauthier now on the fourth line. So could we see him in the AHL very soon? Speaking of AHL, Alexander Georgiev. We have to touch on this every week until this guy can make a save. Now, I'm putting this out there. This is not just on Georgiev. I've watched a lot of Colorado Avalanche games thus far in this early season. They're so polarizing with all the star power they have on their team. They can't get a save. How would you attack that front if you're an owner of Georgiev right now, Jake?
They stink. They just do. They're not the Colorado Avalanche that we've been used to over the last 4 or 5 years. I think that's hard for myself and a lot of other people to come to grips with, I guess, because we're so used to them being this dominant team, especially at Ball Arena. But they have major issues, Nick. I know Georgiev's been a lightning rod, and he should be. He's been horrible. He's underperforming. He can't make a save. Defensively, they're a mess in their own zone. They have no depth scoring up front. You've got Miles Wood, unfortunately, looks like he's going to be out long term, but he was like a second line winger for them. So they just have no depth, struggles in their own end, goaltending issues. You can go down the list of things wrong in Colorado right now.
I think they're in trouble, and the worst thing possible when waking up today, I found out that no team's ever won the cup after starting the season with 4 straight losses. And who's got a futures bet on Colorado to win the cup? Yours truly. Slow starts, player-wise, fantasy-wise. Zach Hyman, no points in 4. Elias Pettersson, 1 assist in three games, looks disinterested. Steven Stamkos, no points in 3 games. Who of those three most concerns you, Jake?
I got to do a call him out on Elias Pettersson. Like, this guy's got to wake up, man. He's making so much money. And look, I actually picked the Canucks to miss the playoffs this year. I'm not going to victory lap that a few games into the season. It's a long season. There is talent in Vancouver, but I did feel like they were going to take a step back this year. It kind of seems like that whole team is just looking at JT Miller and saying, can you do something for us? Can you carry this team, put us on your back? And Elias Pettersson's making way too much money to do what he's doing. Can he start shooting the puck, Nick? Like, this guy, it seems a struggle for him to get 3 shots in a game. So I would say I'm worried about EP40. I need to see a little something out of him.
Yeah, we all thought Vancouver would be regression candidates. They've started as such. The betting market hasn't really adjusted just yet. But on Pettersson, just again, looks disinterested. And that scares me. If I'm using a top 2 fantasy pick on a guy, I want a bona fide stud. A guy night in, night out is going to produce for me. And the numbers back it up for Pettersson, but he's got to get cooking here. It's up to Rick Tocchet to get him going. But for me, it's Steven Stamkos. I just wondered about being with one organization for such a big period of time and now going to Nashville, how that transition would look. I expected a slow start, and I think it's going to be difficult for him to find his footing, at least in the first year with Nashville. But he's been really quiet. The shots on goal are picking up, but I just wonder, up the middle, like Braden Point's no longer there. You got no Kucherovs and guys like that in Nashville, Jake.
Well, and now they're asking him to play center because, yeah, they went out and got a defenseman and two wingers in the offseason, right? And they didn't fix the center ice position, which is a huge problem, especially if you're trying to win in the Central Division. So asking him to play a bit of a different role than maybe he was accustomed to these last few years in Tampa Bay, I would certainly follow your concern there. And I think on the Preds in general, Nick, probably a team I'm fading until further notice. It's about a pick 'em Thursday night against the Edmonton Oilers. Oilers coming off of a, you know, emotional comeback win. I think the Oilers keep rolling and the Preds struggles continue.
It's just a bizarre landscape for me in general right now in the NHL, where you like talk about a new coach bump. More often than not, it's a thing in pro sports. But when there's been, what, 18 coaching changes in the last like year and a half in the NHL, is it really a thing anymore, Jake? Like even with Nashville, Andrew Brunette did a great job last year, but if he can't get going here, I think he's in trouble.
Well, you're the coach bump guy. I always love when we get into that midseason point. There's like five or six changes, and you always throw out the tweets, right? And you get the update on the record. I love that. It actually keeps everything in one spot. When half the league gets fired, it's hard to really spin that narrative anymore. But yeah, I do think that there it does still exist. It's just, I think it's such a short-term thing. At the end of the day, the players on the ice aren't changing, and that's really all that matters. So you could fire a coach, you could bring somebody in, maybe get that 1 week, 2 week sugar rush, but it's not going to change the complexity of a roster.
You talk about a sugar rush. Mark Scheifele, 3 games, 4 goals, 2 assists. Couple guys off to really good starts. I owe Sam Reinhardt an apology. I thought he was going to get his bread and then call it a day, but he has been incredible, especially in a time for need for the Florida Panthers without Barkov, without Tkachuk. 5 games so far for Reinhardt, 4 goals, 4 assists. He's been unbelievable. So is Mark Stone. Everybody's so afraid to draft Mark Stone in fantasy hockey. 4 games, 2 goals, 8 points. These guys are off to hot starts, Jake.
I actually got chirped in a couple of leagues for drafting Mark Stone because everyone's like, well, he's gonna be hurt. And I get it. We might be talking a couple of weeks from now and he's hurt and he's on LTIR and Vegas is doing that thing again. But by all accounts, he was healthy coming into this year. And I don't know if Vegas has a plan to throw someone on LTIR eventually, but you just hope it's not Mark Stone. And I just think that there's so much upside, especially for where he was getting drafted in leagues this year, Nick. And that top line in Vegas looks special. Like, I think Eichel is making an early case for the Hart Trophy. Very early, I understand. But still, I think what Eichel is doing is very impressive there in Vegas, and Mark Stone right along for the ride. I'm a huge believer in what he could do this year, assuming he can play close to 82 games.
Props to you mentioning the Hart Trophy 9 days into the NHL regular season. But you are correct. Vegas is off to a good start. Surprise, surprise. Jack Eichel's been fantastic. The injury bug, as we'll continue to reference on every single podcast, just ugly. Sean Durzi goes down for Utah out indefinitely. Juuso Välimäki's running the first power play, so look out for that. Devon Taves, day-to-day lower body injury. Sam Molinsky and Sam Girard are two guys you want to look at if you're looking for a bit of production. We talked about Colorado. They can score goals. They can't keep the puck out of the net. That's a big-time issue. Externally, Jake, any of these options you like that I will bring up? Oliver Ekman-Larsson, Justin Falk, Lane Hutson, Philip Broberg.
Okay, I'm glad you brought up OEL. I did want to hit him at some point on this podcast. I think it's Ekman-Larsson season. This is what I thought John Klingberg was going to do. And we know John Klingberg ended up on Robida Island or wherever the heck he is now. But I think OEL is doing what they wanted Klingberg to do. And he's taken over that first power play now. I think the Ekman-Larsson shot prop has now become a thing, something to maybe look at while we're still getting some pretty good prices on it. I'm a believer in his role on that team right now. And we know that they can score a lot of goals. And I'm loving what I'm seeing a few games in from Ekman-Larsson. So if he's still hanging around out there, to me, he's a must pick up right now.
Yeah, that's probably the guy I'm picking up as well. Most importantly, he's running the first power play in it. So that means exposure to the big boys when it comes to Toronto's power play. And Ekman-Larsson, team high in ice time the last couple games. So look out for that. Other injuries, Victor Olofsson down. Doesn't look good. Lower body injury. Alexander Holtz is a guy you would think could step up in that Vegas lineup. Externally, Teuvo Teravainen, I think, has had a good start. 2.0 here with Chicago. Andre Kuzmenko in the upstart Calgary Flames and Jared McCann with Seattle. Anybody else come to mind in terms of wingers?
Well, you mentioned Chicago, and I did want to hit that quickly as well. Chicago and San Jose, like I don't think that we're seeing horrible teams this year. I think that's what's changed for me from last year to this year is, yes, these teams are still bad. They're still going to lose their fair share of games, but they're at least competitive and they're not going to be a free 2 points every single night. So from a fantasy perspective, I think we could find value in that top six in Chicago, the top six in San Jose, because despite the fact they'll probably lose the game, I think we're going to see a little bit more in the way of offense from those teams.
Some other guys who have caught my eye on a watch list, I guess I would call it. Josh Norris has been pretty hot for the Ottawa Senators. Alex Laferriere with LA. Brent Clark as well. Morgan Frost, the numbers aren't there, Jake, but I've watched a lot of the Flyers thus far. He's got the exposure to Matvei Michkov, who scores his first two goals of his NHL career. But three assists in three games, but there seems to be a bit of pop in Morgan Frost's game to start the year.
The Flyers are feisty. They are. Even the way they were defending that game against Edmonton, I thought they were going to hang on. But I like Frost. I mentioned Forrester as well on a previous episode. He's a guy, just go look at his ice time that Torts is giving this guy. So when you see that, I kind of like it. I'm thinking, okay, he's going to be in some offensive situations. So Forrester, Frost, obviously Michkov is a guy that is going to be well-owned in leagues. But I still think there's a lot of value in that Philly lineup.
All right, let's get to today's guest, co-host and producer from SiriusXM NHL Network Radio. It is Tyler Mataraz for his first ever appearance on the pod. What's going on, Ty?
Nothing much. Good to see you guys and good to have hockey back.
Great to have you. Lots going on in the early fantasy hockey season, Ty. What stood out for you thus far?
A lot of good teams being bad. I think that's one thing. A lot of people love the Nashville Predators for one this year, and all of a sudden they can't buy a win. The Colorado Avalanche, if you were an Alex Georgiev fantasy owner, you are not a happy person right now. And having Connor McDavid hasn't really paid off early. So a lot's going on with some superstars maybe being quiet. And a lot of players you maybe drafted in like the fourth, fifth or sixth round, like a Geno Malkin, are really excelling early on.
You mentioned Georgiev, Ty. He's been a complete disaster. Jari's been a disaster in Pittsburgh as well. Basically, every goaltender I own as well has been a disaster. Can you help me get a save? Like, outside of the top guys, is there any goaltender that you trust right now in fantasy hockey?
Not really, to be honest. Like, Lucas Dostal has been a savior for me. I picked him up after my draft, and Lucas Dostal got a shutout in game one, ended up with that overtime victory in the game against the Utah HC, but not really. Like, Sergei Bobrovsky has been pretty good. I think Andrei Vasilevsky is going to do all right. I guess the answer to your question, Jake, is Igor Shesterkin. I think Igor is probably going to be the number one goaltender in fantasy at the end of the year, but goalies are always tough, especially when you're in a deep league, whether it's 14 or 16 team league.
Stop sleeping on Connor Hellebuck again. Okay. Winnipeg's off to a great start. They're doing great things. Are we sleeping on them again, Ty? Is that what's happening here?
Everybody is. And yeah, I kind of disrespected Connor Hellebuck, I guess, not mentioning his name, but we just do that with the Jets in general, don't we? Like, they're not that sexy team that people like to watch. Like, they have Kyle Connor, who's unbelievable. So is Connor Hellebuck when he's on his game. But no one really talks about the Jets. So we're disrespecting them early. Can they win that division? Probably not. But Connor Hellebuck's going to be a force to be reckoned with all year and probably going to be the starter at the Four Nations for Team USA.
Ottawa, Buffalo, Detroit, we always group those teams together in the Atlantic. Maybe we want to put Montreal in there as well. They look a little more frisky this year, so maybe they've entered that conversation in the Atlantic, tie through, I guess, 4 to 5 games for most of these teams. Any of those teams jump out to you in the Atlantic that can maybe take a step and push for a playoff spot or any fantasy value on those rosters?
Well, I'm glad you threw Montreal in there, Jake, because the other ones aren't good. Like, Ottawa, you can't trust. If you drafted Linus Allmark hoping he was going to be great, you're like, oh, maybe he's dealing with an injury now and Ottawa's not going to be great again. Buffalo is horrendous. Tage Thompson's kind of going to be fun to have. But other than that, the Sabres are just awful to watch. And in fantasy, I do have Bo Byram, which wasn't a great pick on my part. I'll say that right now, not getting first power play, but we kind of knew that. And I guess to answer your question, Jake, it's Samuel Montembeault. Not a lot of people drafted Montembeault, and all of a sudden, he's kind of carrying the Habs early on. They've been the funnest team to watch out of those four Atlantic Division teams. So I like Samuel Montembeault. I love Cole Caulfield this year. I was telling people to draft him, and both of those players have kind of carried Montreal so far.
Yeah, I think Montembeault at this point is a must-own. Delivered by our good friends over at Skip. Got a really good question. You talked about Utah a couple moments ago. Do I sell high on Dylan Guenther? That is a massive question right now in fantasy hockey, Ty.
I'd say no. I'd want to keep Dylan Guenther all year. If you're going to get an offer for Dylan Guenther that blows you out of the water, yeah, I would sell high on him. But he's so fun to have. Watching Utah games, and you saw it when he was playing on the Coyotes, you saw it at the World Juniors, this kid could absolutely just rip the puck. He finally picked up his first assist of the year in that Anaheim game I mentioned. So early Cy Young candidate for Dylan Guenther, but I'd keep him on my roster. I wish I drafted him, and whoever has him in our league, I might be offering a trade to pretty soon.
Another listener question I wanted to hit both you guys with. Ty, we could start with you, Nick. I'd like to hear your take on this as well. Matty Beniers or Pierre-Luc Dubois moving forward? Ty, you go first.
You're not giving me great options, Jake. I'm not going to go with PLD. I will go with Matty Beniers. There's just so much more upside there. And Washington's just such a weird team. But at times, the Kraken can be more exciting. And offensively, last year, they were pretty brutal. As we know, they didn't score a lot of goals. But I think it would be Matty Beniers. How about you, Nick?
I would go with C. Anton Lindell. I don't have an answer. Like, I'm not interested in either file. I don't know what Seattle did in the offseason. Chandler Stephenson, I just keep looking every night in the box score to see if he picks up a point. I know he wasn't picked up for points, but when you get paid that much coin, you better step up. I think for the purpose of this question, I guess I'll go with Pierre-Luc Dubois because I think it's his final opportunity in the NHL. If he can't figure things out, I think there's a buyout coming and say two, that's it, that's all. And I just don't believe in Seattle, Jake.
You sounded so enthused when you had to pick Pierre-Luc Dubois there. You sound so fired up about that one. Ty, I did want to ask you too. I did mention goaltending a little bit earlier. Are you a believer in Anthony Stolarz in Toronto? Like Joe Wall hurt again. Can we trust him to stay healthy? Is he going to end up being one of the great fantasy stories? Because I think the Leafs are going to win a lot of games this year. And if Wall can't, you know, stay on the ice, Stolarz might end up being the guy.
No, he's kind of going to be up there with Samuel Montembeau, isn't he? For guys that maybe weren't drafted as starting goaltenders and were picked up off waivers. I'd love to have Stolarz. I remember in the draft I was looking at him late. He obviously got taken. Joe Wall was taken above him, as we know. But the injury concerns for Wall just scare everyone. They scare Leaf fans. They scare fantasy owners. I wish I had Anthony Stolarz, but I do think he's going to be a big story. And at the end of the day, I don't know if you agree with this, Nick. I think Stolarz is going to be the guy in Toronto this season.
Well, the other guy just can't stay healthy. I mean, he's developing a bit of a reputation. Joseph Wall, when he's in there, a good goalie, but just can't stay healthy. Ty, what about Los Angeles? I thought it was very, very interesting. We'll see that Darcy Kuemper gets lit up for 8 goals and all of a sudden he's banged up. You got a feel for him. But that blue line is really, really thin, minus Drew Doughty right now and others. Does LA make the playoffs and fantasy-wise? How are you looking at that team right now?
No, they don't make the playoffs. Fantasy-wise, Fiala and Kempe are always fun to have. Brant Clark finally had a little three-apple night for me as I drafted him late, and Drew Doughty, unfortunately, is out for a while. But, yeah, those are the three guys you're going to want in fantasy. Darcy Kuemper as well, when he's healthy, I think can be really, really good. The start where he gave up, 7 goals wasn't great, and now he's injured, and it's Riddick and Copley. But they're not going to be a playoff team. I think Fiala and Kempe are going to be the guys there. Kopitar's hat-trick was great on night one of the season, but he might not be able to continue that pace. And they're just a weird team, not playing a defensive style anymore and still kind of are. The shootout was fun that they had 7-6, but very weird team that won't be in this year.
Any interest in the doom and gloom teams from the last couple of years? Ty, Chicago, San Jose, they look more competitive to me through a few games, right? They're still going to lose a lot, but I think they're more competitive. I think we could actually find some fantasy value in San Jose or Chicago. So any of those complementary pieces there interesting you moving forward?
Yeah, I like San Jose of the two teams. Connor Bedard's kind of just in his own world in Chicago. Bertuzzi hasn't even done anything yet. Neither really has Taylor Hall. But to have Toffoli this year, I think, will be great once Celebrini's back and healthy from his hip injury. William Eklund could be that guy if he can stay on that line. Are we calling them that 70s line, guys? I don't know. We might be stealing that from LA, but Tyler Toffoli was a part of that, so maybe we can run with it. And you know what? Mackenzie Blackwood, like, do you want to spot start Mackenzie Blackwood at times in favorable matchups? Maybe. Like, I'm kind of doing it with Dostal and Anaheim. When he has some favorable matchups, can start him over other goalies. But I like the Sharks way more than the Blackhawks.
We've got a Warsawski believer, I guess, on this podcast, even without Macklin Celebrini. Last question from me. What advice would you give to fantasy owners? Obviously, patience is a virtue, Ty, but early on in the season, there's been a lot of injuries, a lot of goaltenders acting up and players not producing. What advice would you give?
It's just don't panic. You can't panic early on, like 1, 2, 3 weeks into the season. If you're near the bottom of your standings, everything's going to be so tight. Like, there's not going to be one or two teams in your league running away with things. But if we're at week 7, 8, 9, 10, and you're near the bottom of the standings, that's when I'd start to panic. But we're so early on in the fantasy season. I know me and Jake had a pretty good battle in week one of our leagues. So that was fun, and we're going to be battling all year, I'm sure. And I just wouldn't panic this early.
I was going to say, I'm in a league with you, Ty, and I was panicking. You were up like 8-1 on me early in the week. I'm like, oh boy, I'm going to be at the bottom of the standings early. I was able to salvage some categories. So congrats to you on the week one W. Last one for me as well. What do you do with Patrick Kane right now? This is a listener question. That Red Wings lineup, tricky to figure out, but do you believe in Patrick Kane to get it going in Detroit this year?
Yes and no. 12-team league. I think he's pretty droppable. we're in a 16-team league, you and I, Jake. Like, I would keep Patrick Kane. It's funny, this is asked because I was texting one of our mutual friends today, and he sends me his roster. He's like, what should I do with some of these players? I'm like, well, you can drop JT Compher. You can drop this guy. I was like, Patrick Kane in a 14-team league, you might as well just keep, even though he has a slow start. So once Showtime gets it going, him and Dylan Larkin can kind of do what they did last year. He's going to pick up his points, especially on the power play. I'd kind of wait and see with Kane. If nothing's going well within the first month or two of the season, though, I think he's even droppable in a bigger league.
Imagine being a Red Wings goalie, guys. Like, you start the year as a starter, and then next thing you know, you're on waivers. Tyler, thank you so much for your time today. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me on, guys. Good to see you.
Bringing in Pete Jensen now for a look at wagering and the betting landscape in the NHL market. Pete, first and foremost, the Buffalo Sabres. How you feeling?
Not good, unless you're doing, yeah, the Peterka goal prop. He came back from injury from the concussion on Wednesday, like Jake said. Also, Dylan Cousins, wanted to mention him. No points on the season, but has 19 shots on goal in five games. So the Dylan Cousins shot prop on the second line, especially with the positive ripple effect, will at least get you through the day, I think, so far. But yeah, I don't know what to make of this team. The secondary defensemen have been really absent. Guys like Owen Power and Bowen Byram. It's really disappointing.
Props are the only thing I'm touching in Buffalo right now, guys. Peterka, Cousins, something like that. The other prop I've been touching lately, Logan Stankoven, still plus money for a point on a nightly basis. He was plus money the other night against the Sharks for a point. I think he's plus 120, something in that range, Thursday night for a point. Maybe we continue with the shot prop. I think we got to ride Stankoven until further notice because we're still getting some pretty good prices.
I'm riding with you, Jake. Some things I like for Thursday's card, 11 games. Can't wait to just sit on my couch and watch hockey. Vegas and Tampa. I like the over. 6.5. Four straight overs between those two teams. I think Tampa's due for a loss some point in time. Vegas coming off a disappointing loss to Washington. And Vancouver at Florida. Can't believe I'm going to say this. Give me the Canucks money line. The Panthers have burned me a lot early on, Pete, I'll tell you.
Yeah, it's tough because they're man down, second man down, right? Adam Boqvist is back, so maybe get back on him in the power play point props and stuff like that. Aaron Ekblad's been really disappointing to me. We got a fan question about him. I would probably drop him in all fantasy formats, unfortunately. Still a big Gus Forsling fan. And when Boqvist is healthy, I've always liked his per game metrics. Goals per game among defensemen is always fairly high. So get back in on Adam Boqvist, a nice preseason trend for Florida. But yeah, they're really up and down.
I might have to go head to head with you on that one, Nick. I seeing that price, it feels like a trap. Panthers barely a favorite on home ice. I'm like, what am I missing here? So usually when I see that, it does go the other way. So I don't blame you for going with the Canucks there. I mentioned it earlier in the episode. Edmonton in Nashville to take on the struggling Preds. I don't know if Edmonton's a get-right spot. I know they haven't looked amazing to start the year, but I think they've maybe found something in that last game, and you're getting them around to pick them against the Nashville Predators team I still think is trying to find their identity.
Yeah, that's going to be a very interesting one because both teams need 2 points in that game. Pardon the cliche, but one final note on that Nashville-Edmonton game. Everybody knows when the Oilers go to Nashville to hit Leon Draisaitl anytime goal, I think I got it at like plus 260. So the market suggests it's not going to happen, but I think you have to have a bit of a sprinkle, no, Jake?
Absolutely, and Leon found it the other night, right? He was the guy that I was looking to all game. I'm like, he's going to be the one to step up and do something in this game. You know, he set up a couple guys that hit posts. He had a few good quality looks. Eventually, he gets the assist on the tying goal, and then he gets the winner in overtime. So he's coming in with a lot of confidence. If you listen to his post game though, after the win, sounded like a loss. This guy's never happy. So he's not going to stop at one win. And like you mentioned, he's been so good against the Preds. I do think that we ride the goal prop. Obviously, the point prop, you're not going to get as good of odds, but I think could be a nice parlay piece on Thursday.
I'm going to go with a revenge, to take a page out of your book, Nick. Revenge look for two teams ago, Victor Arvidsson. I like the lineup placement in the top six against Nashville. No points on the season so far. A number of shots on goal, but I still think that if he gets that lineup placement, this is a guy, right, guys, that has had like multiple, I think four different seasons with at least 225 shots on goal. I could see him scoring a goal or two and maybe having five shots on goal to boot.
Pete, I like where your head's at. I'm going to stick with the revenge theme just to wrap this segment. Dean Evason revenge game, the second in like 10 days, Minnesota at Columbus on Saturday. I'm going to play the Columbus money line. I like the way that team has played early on. They burned me earlier in the week Against the Florida Panthers, a late goal in the second period really, really hurt. But I'm going to hop on the revenge wagon there with Dean Evason. Pete, I understand there's a couple goalies moving forward that you have your mindset on. Obviously, Spencer Knight's another guy I want to bring up on today's podcast too.
Yeah, he was really good the other night, like you were saying, in the Columbus game. I think that Jake Allen is being underestimated in fantasy. I think he's going to go a long way in the New Jersey Devils, having that bounce-back season, which they've already started through six games, looking really good with four wins. And Jake Allen already has a shutout, 970 save percentage. He's the close 1B to Jacob Markstrom. I don't think that Markstrom is going to be far and away like a 60-game goalie this year. I think Jake Allen's going to play, you know, 30, 35 and have really quality efficiency. So look at him for sure. And then, you know, also looking around the league, Dustin Wolf is a huge surprise so far. I don't quite trust the Flames and their staying power, but they're going to be a lot better than the 28 wins that we at NHL Fantasy projected them for. They're probably going to have 35, 40 wins. And Dustin Wolf for the Calder Trophy, wanted to note it, plus 2,500. So you could still get good long shot odds on him.
You mentioned Jake Allen, Pete. The Devils, really good. I'm a believer in this Devils team this year. I think this is the Devils team from 2 years ago, maybe even a little bit better. Jack Hughes assist prop. That's what we're riding here until further notice, plus money.
I love that team can actually get a save now, whether it's Jake Allen or Jacob Markstrom's had a really, really strong start to this season. So once again, many thanks to Tyler Mataraz from SiriusXM NHL Network Radio for popping on the podcast for the first time ever today. Coming up next week, Monday, Week 3 Waiver Wire Edition. We're moving quickly. We're almost into the month of November. Many thanks to producer Bob Bender. For Jay Kahn and Pete Jensen, I'm Nick Alberga. You've been listening to NHL Fantasy on Ice, delivered by Skip, the official food delivery app of the NHL.